Trying to share my screen. Okay, can you guys see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. So I know that before we went over strings, basically we just went over how they're mostly words and they're in quotation marks, but there's more to strings than we went over. So that's what we're going to be going over first. You guys already learned that strings are surrounded by single quotation marks or double quotation marks. So, yeah, we already learned about this. You can print out strings just by putting either a double quotation mark like this or a single one. Assigning a string to a variable, we also already learned this. In order to make a variable with a string inside, you just put the name of your variable equals and then your string. Your string doesn't always have to be hello. You can change whatever you want inside of the quotation marks, but just make sure that you have quotation marks around it if you want it to be a string. Okay, I don't think we went over this one yet, but this one is called a multi-line string. And so basically, the strings that we've learned about before are just one line. For example, when you say hello, that only takes up one line of your code. But there's something called multi-line strings where you can, for example, write a whole sentence or maybe even a paragraph by using three quotes like this in the beginning and the end. So if you put three in the beginning and three in the end, then you can keep pressing enter in order to make new lines. Let me try to show you these. Okay. So here's the example that they gave. When I press run and print A, you can see that there's multiple lines like this, even though it's only one variable. I can also change it to like this. Hello, my. So you can change whatever you want inside, and it'll still work like this. So every single thing that you put on new line is going to be printed out like that. So that's what a multi-line string is. And this is just saying that you can also use single quotes. Whether you use these double quotes or the single quotes, it doesn't matter. Okay, so in Python, there's something called an array. It's basically the variables that we learned about so far is just like one container, right? But arrays are like a collection of containers in one bigger group. So in Python, strings can represent arrays, meaning that, let me try this one. So here we have this example. It says, hello world. And every single one of these characters, H, E, L, L, O, it can be considered as separate characters. It doesn't have to be a whole word. So So when we say print A and then use these square brackets and put 1 inside and you press run, it prints out E. And that's because in Python, if you're using an array, each part of the array has an index. Okay, so let me just show you guys like this. 0, 1, 3, 4. Okay, so this h right here has an index of 0. Every string or array is going to start with the index of 0. So whether I put, let's say I write class, C is still going to be index of 0 because it's the first letter in the string. Even if I put numbers in the string, like 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, this 0 has an index of 0 because it's the first part of the string. So if I have hello world and I want to print the first index, we go 0, 1. E is the first index of that string, which is why if we press run, the program prints E. Let's say I want to print O. You can see that corresponds to 0, 1, 2, 3, the fourth index. So if I want to print O, I'm just going to say print A of 4. And if you press run, you can see it prints O. Also, commas and spaces are considered as parts of the array. So let's say I wanted to print out the space in the middle of them. I would print out 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I'm going to print A of 6, and it should print out just, if you highlight it, you can see there's a space, but it shows as nothing because it's a space. So basically an array is just breaking down every single part of the string, every single letter or every single number into its own component. Also, there's something called loops in Python, and we're gonna learn about it in a whole nother unit later. But for now, all you need to know is that it's possible to loop through a string. So, as I said before, arrays are like a collection of singular parts, which means that this word right here is a collection of B, A, N, A, N, A. So when I say for x in banana, print x, let me try running it. You can see it prints out every single letter in the string. That's because I'm making a variable x, and then when I say in banana, that means that x is going to represent every single one of these letters. So I say print x, and then it's going to print out every single letter when I press run, like this. Let's say I want to change the word. I'm going to say hello. It's still going to work. It's going to print out every single letter of hello because x, our new variable, is running through every single letter. First it goes h, e, l, l, and then o. It does every single part separately. So yeah, no matter what word you put here, it's going to print it out separately. Even if you put numbers, because it's considering it as a string, it prints out every single one by itself. Okay. And you don't need to worry about that part too much, the for loops, because we're going to go over it later. Okay, so string length. Basically, hopefully you guys remember how earlier I said that each part of a string has something called an index, which is basically just the position of that part. So, for example, the position of H is 0. That means that it's index 0. The position of E is 1, so the index is 1. The length is finding the total number of parts in a string. So in this one, you can count. It has H, E, L, L, O. So that's 5 plus the comma is 6. The space counts as 7. And then from here on, it's 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. So if you want to get the length of A, you can run it and you'll see it says 13. That's because there's 13 characters in here, including the spaces. So if I, for example, say class, it's going to be 5 because class consists of 5 characters, C-L-A-S-S. And the same as before, you can do this with numbers. You can see this is like 123,456, but this is not an integer, so that's not what you read it as. You read it as singular numbers. So if I were to print the length of A, it's not going to print 1, it's going to print 6, because every single one of these numbers is considered as a separate number. Okay. So yeah, no matter what I change this to, I could say hi, and I run it, and the length of that is 2. So that's why that prints out. Okay. Okay, so a lot of the times strings are sentences. Like in this example, it says TXT equals the best things in life are free. That's a sentence. So obviously sentences have words in them. And maybe sometimes you're going to want to check if there's a certain word or something like that that's in your string. So let me paste this into here. In this example, the variable, this is a string, and inside of it, it says the best things in life are free. When we say print free in TXT, we're checking if this word free is inside of this string. So you can see here that free is the last word. So if we print run, it's going to say true because it's true that free is in this string. But let's say I write print 123 in TXT. There's no part of this string that has 123. So if I run, hold on. Okay. So if I press run, it's going to be false because 123 is not in this string at all. If I say, so before the example I gave was free, that was true. If I say best, that's right here as well. So if I press run, it's going to be true. And then you can do this with numbers too. You can say like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. If I say print 45 in TXT, that's gonna print true because here we have 4, 5. But if I say 4, 5, and then, if I say print 3, 4 in TXT and I press run, it's false because you can see here there's a 3 and there's a 4, but they're not together like I said right here. In order for this to be true, I need to put them together like this. And then if I press run, it's going to say true because this code, this string contains 3 and 4 together. But if I put a space in between them, it doesn't work. Yeah, so basically this function, something in TXT, is going to print out true whenever this string is contained inside of this. And also, you can just say print 34 in, for example, 3, 4, 5, 6. 3, 4, 5, 6. And it's going to be still true. You don't always need to use a variable like in this example. Because here, we made a string called TXT, and then we checked if this was inside of it. But you don't need to do that all of the time. You can just get rid of this and make your own string without having to make a whole another variable. Okay. Also, last week we learned about if statements. Hopefully you guys remember, but if not, I'm going to quickly review it right now. So whenever we use an if statement, our code is going to do whatever's inside the if statement if this part is true. So this example, we're using the same string. It said, the best things in life are free. Our if statement says, if free is in TXT, our variable, then we're going to print, yes, free is present. So I'm going to run this code, and it prints out, yes, free is present. That's because right here, it says, if free in TXT. Free is right here in the variable, so we know that this statement is true. So it moves on to do this. But let's say I want to do if 123 in TXT, yes, 123 is present. And I press run, nothing's going to happen because I said if 123 in TXT. In this string, there's no place where it says 123. So that's not true. And then it's not going to print this. Also, as a reminder, make sure if you want something to be in your if statement, you don't need to do anything except for make sure to indent it. You could just press tab in order to indent. So if I get rid of this and then I try my code, you're going to get an error. It says indentation error, expected an indent block. That means we need to indent right here. So, yeah, make sure if you want something to be in your if statement, you need an indent. And now if I run it, it's going to do the same thing as before. It's not going to print anything out because this is not true. And you can try it with other examples too, like this is another example of a sentence. You can use the same example. If you press run, there's no place in this string here where it says 123. So that's why nothing prints out. But if we say if fox in TXT, we're going to say yes, fox is present. When we press run, it prints something out because this right here is true. Right here it says fox, which means that this whole statement is true, and then it prints something. Okay. And then this is an example where it's the opposite of what I just showed you guys. It's called check if not, and then instead of using, here we used in, but here we're going to use not in. That means we want to check if something's not present. So, again, we have this string. The best things in life are free. And we want to check if expensive is not in TXT. Let's try pressing run. And then it's going to be true because there's no place here where expensive, it says expensive. So it's true. It's not in this string. And so that's what prints out. Let's say we print out, let's say we want to check if life is not in TXT. If we press run, it's going to say false because right here, it says the word life. So life is in TXT, meaning that this statement is false. And then it prints out false. Yeah, and you can do the same thing with numbers too. We want to say like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And then you want to print 0. In this string, there's no place where it says 0. So it's true. 0 is not in TXT. So if you press run, it's going to be true. Okay. Yeah, so again, like we showed before, you can use an if statement if you want to. It's the same thing, except instead of just saying in, we say not in TXT. So TXT equals this again. If expensive is not in TXT, we're going to print no expensive is not present. And we press run, and it prints that out because expensive is not in TXT. This part is true, so it prints out this. Okay, so like I said before, strings can be arrays. And that might be a little confusing to you guys, but I'm going to explain more about that right now. Also, if you guys have questions, please put it in the chat and then the teachers can help answer. Okay, so I'm going to start with the next part. This one is called slicing. And basically what you're doing is you're literally slicing a string. So let me paste this into here. Here we have a variable called b, and inside it has hello world. We want to print b from 2 to 5. This represents, like, it's like the same thing as going 2 to 5. But we put this instead. So from index 2 to 5. Like I said before, indexes start from 0. So h would be 0, e is 1, l is 2. So this is where it's going to start. And then we have l, which is index 4, and then o, which is index 5. Oh, sorry, I counted wrong. L is 2, the second L is 3, O is 4, and then the comma is 5. So if you press run, it says LLO. So when you say you want to print something from 2 to 5, that's saying you're going to go from 2 until right before 5. You don't include 5. If you want to include the comma in what you print out, you need to say 6. And we press run, and it says LLO, comma. And you can change the numbers however you want. If you do, like, a negative number, though, it's not going to work. And then, also, if you put 0, I can just print stuff like hello. And if I print 5, we're going to leave out the comma, so it's just going to be hello. You can also print out just world by itself. You need to count the index. So H is 1. Oh, sorry, H is 0. This is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. W starts at index 7. So I'm going to say 7. And then we keep counting until this exclamation mark. So this is 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. When I say I want to print B from 7 to 12, that means I just want to print out world by itself. So, yeah, that's how you can basically just get one part of a string. Before we learned that if you just put one number by itself like this, that means you just want to get that single character. But if you put a colon and then another number, that means you want to print out this index up to this index. And we can change the name of our variable too. If I call AB, then I need to rename this as AB. If I call this STR to represent string, then I also have to change this part to STR. Okay. Another, and then again, you can use numbers for this. So 7, 8. Let's say I want to print out 1, 2, 3. If you check, that's index 0, 1, 2. So I'm going to say 0 up until 3 so that it includes 3. I press run and it just says 1, 2, 3. So again, slicing just means that you're getting a small part of the string. Okay, so there's also something called slicing from the start. Basically, what this means is that you normally write two numbers like this, but you don't need to write the first number if it's going to be zero. So I'm going to show you guys this example right here. This variable is called hello world, and we say print B. We don't have a number, but we have a colon and then our second number. Normally, you're supposed to have something before, but this is a special case where you can just leave out the first number because it's saying that it wants you to print out from the beginning up until 5. I'm going to press run, and it's just going to say hello. So again, H is index 0, E is 1, L is 2, this is 3, 4, 5 is the comma. So we're saying print up until here. So yeah, doing this is the same thing as saying 0 to 5 like this. And then there's another thing called slicing to the end, which is just the opposite of what we did. For this one, we left out the first number. For this one, we're going to leave out the second number. So when we do this, it's saying, hello world, and then you have print B from 2 and on. So H is 0, E is 1, L is 2. So we just want to print out L and on, up until the end. It doesn't matter how long the string is. We could keep saying hello, hello, hello. It's always just going to print out from index 2 up until the end. And again, you can do this with numbers. You're going to press run. And then it prints out from the second index right here to the end. Okay. And then this is something called negative indexing. Basically, you're going backwards. So before we learned that the indexes are like 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 8, 9, 10, so on. But this time, we're starting from the back. So the very last one would be negative 1. Okay. This is negative 1. Okay. I can't write on here, but I'll just try to explain it in words as best as I can. So this exclamation mark is going to represent index negative 1, D is negative 2, L is negative 3, and so on. So when we go from the front and count the indexes, we start from 0. But from this one, we start from negative 1 because let's say you want to access, let's say this is index 0, and this is also index 0. If you want to access index 0, how is your code going to know whether you want to access H or the exclamation mark? So that's why when we go from the front and on, we start from 0. But if we go from the back and this way, we go negative 1. So like in this example, it wants to print out B of negative 5 to negative 2. We could count where that is. So this is negative 1, this is negative 2, negative 3, negative 4, negative 5. So we go from negative 5 up until negative 2. So ORL. And I'm going to press run, and then you can see that's what it prints out. Okay. So, there's also a way you can modify strings. It basically just means that you can change a string that you already made by using something called methods. So, methods are basically something that's, it like comes with Python. You don't need to make it yourself, I guess. So, for example, there's this method called uppercase. And what this does is it just changes a string to uppercase. We can try it ourselves. A is hello world. We use a.upper, and then you press run, and then it says hello world in all uppercase. So, yeah, here it says the upper method returns the string in uppercase. That's what we see right here. And we could also make this, like, a random word. You can see it's all lowercase. And then we do a.upper, and then it changes all to uppercase. Yeah. And if you use, like, numbers like this, obviously, there's no uppercase or lowercase for numbers, so it's not going to change your string at all. But then, if you go like a, if you have like numbers and letters, it's only going to change the letters to uppercase and just keeps all the numbers the same. And then we have the opposite of that is called a, just lower. So lower method returns the string in lowercase. Yeah, it's pretty simple. It's just the same thing, but instead of saying upper, you say lower because it's lowercase. So I'm going to put lower here. And then if I have a whole string that's uppercase and I say a.lower, I'm changing it to lowercase. Now it's all lowercase like this. And again, if I have only numbers, it's not going to do anything. But if I have letters and numbers, it's going to just change everything to lowercase. And let's say there's already something that's lowercase, it's just not going to change because there's nothing to change. So here we just have lowercase a, b, h. And then the rest of the numbers. There's also something called white space. It's basically just extra space in your strings. So here we have space hello world comma space hello comma world exclamation mark and then another space. Normally you don't start your sentences with a space or end them with a space like this. You just have your sentence like without these spaces. But if you don't want to format it like that, you can just use this method called strip, and you put your variable name before it, and it will, if we press run, it just prints the same thing but without spaces in the beginning or the end. So if I go like this and make bunches of spaces, I press run, even then it gets rid of all of them and just says hello world like this. So yeah, and again, same thing works for numbers. If there's like spaces before and after a string, it just gets rid of it. Okay. Then there's this other method called replace, and basically what it does, it literally just replaces something with another character. So for example here, we're saying a.replace h and j. H is what we want to replace, and j is what we want to put instead of it. So if I... Oh, sorry. This is the wrong one. I'll put it in here. Okay. If I press run, now it's going to say Jello World, because we replaced the H with a J. If I say replace W with J and I press run, it's going to say Hello World. So yeah, you can just replace any type of part of a string that you want to replace by using dot replace. Okay, and then you can also replace into whole entire words. Like if you say hello, you can replace it with hi. We're gonna press run, and now it says hi world. Or I could say replace world with class, and I'm gonna press run, and it says hello class. So yeah, this is just an easy way if you want to change one part of your string. Okay. Now this is another method called split, and basically what it does, it's kind of the same as slicing. You're just cutting your code. You're just cutting your string. So here when we say a.split, comma, that means we want to split our string according to the comma. So to the left of it is hello, and to the right of it is space world exclamation mark. We're going to press run, and now we have... There's one part that says hello, and another part that says space world exclamation mark. So, this kind of format, this is what an array is. It's different components, but it's separated by a comma. So that's how it prints out. You can ignore all of these, like, bracket, and then you can ignore the single quotation mark, and also you can ignore this comma. All you need to look at is the things inside of the quotation marks. So here that would be hello and world. So we can see that it successfully split our code. You can also say split according to E. We're going to press run, and now it says H and then the rest of the thing, because H is to the left of E, and then LLO, comma, world is to the right of it. So, yeah. Okay. Again, that was a lot. So, Hariel, if you guys have any questions, just make sure to put it in chat so that we can help you guys. Okay, I'm gonna move on now. There's something called string concatenation in Python. It's basically you can add different strings, and it's not the same thing as math addition because you can't really do that with like words and letters, but you're basically just squishing them together. Like before we learned about slicing strings and splitting them, but this is the opposite of that. You're mushing them together into one thing. So if I press run, and I have two variables here, hello and world. I say C is A plus B, and then I print C. So C is just A and B squished together, and now it says hello world in one thing. I can do the same thing with like numbers. It's going to say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So because these numbers are strings, meaning that they're all considered separate, it's not considered as one whole number, it's going to just add them by mushing them together. It's not going to like do actual addition with these. If you wanted to do actual addition, you need to take away the quotation marks and make it into an integer. But this is string concatenation, so we're just mushing two strings together. You can put more than two of them together. You can also say D equals 7, 8, 9. And then we can say A plus B plus D. And we press run, and it's all of them combined together. So, yeah. Oh, this one's, so yeah, like I said before, you can add together more than two strings. This string that you're adding in the middle is just a space because let's say you have hello and world. If you take out that space and run it, it's just going to be hello world together, but that doesn't really make sense because hello and world are not one word. So you want to add a space between them. You just say plus, and then you use quotation marks to put a space. And I press run, and now it's hello world as two separate words. I want to say like, hi, class. Hi, comma, class. If I don't put this space and I run it, it's, let me... Okay, if I don't put the space and run it, it's just going to be hi, comma, class without any spaces. But that's not really correct grammar because you need a space between the two words. So I'm going to add a space using quotation marks and then press run. And now it's properly spaced out. And it doesn't need to be just to make your grammar correct. In case you just want to have a space between two parts of a string, you can just add a space in the middle. Okay. So string formatting. Formatting in Python is really important because In this example, you can't add an integer to a string. In order to add an integer to a string, you need to make it into a string first and then put it together. So in this example, they have an integer called age and it has the number 36. They have this string and it says, and it's called txt. It has my name is John, comma, I am plus age. What they're trying to do here is saying that my name is John and I am 36. But let's press run. It does not work. It gives you an error. This is because age is an integer and this first part is a string. You can't add integers and strings. One way you can solve this problem is by casting. We learned this in one of our first chapters. So basically, we're just changing age into a string. And you press run, and now you can add them together without having any errors. So now it prints out, my name is John, I am 36. This is another way. It's called, it's just a format method, and that's what it's called, and you just use curly brackets instead. So here I casted the int into a string. You can also do this. It's my name is John and I am. You don't know what you want to put in here yet. That's okay. You can just put curly brackets. But when you print it, you can say txt, which is your variable, dot format age. So basically, we're just saying, I want to replace this curly brackets with the age. And then you don't need to change it into a string. You could just press run and then it's going to print 36. If I change this, I want to print like 20. Your age is 20. You press run and then now it says my name is John and I am 20. So yeah, there are multiple ways to solve problems like that. You guys should just do whatever is more comfortable for you. Okay, and then here's a more complicated example. So in this example, we only used one curly bracket, but let's say you want to use three. This example is using three. You can see here we have quantity, item number, price, and my order. My order, it says, I want blank pieces of item, blank, for something dollars. So again, we have the name of our variable. We're going to use the dot format again, but this time we have different parts. So it says quantity, item number, and price. This is because our quantity is the number of pieces you want. Item, we put our item number, and then our price. So you need to make sure it's in order. Here we have our first blank, our second blank, and our third blank. We want the quantity to go in the first one, item number to go in the second one, and price to go in the third one. So that's why we put it in that order. So if I press run, it's going to say, I want three pieces of item 567 for $49.95. That makes sense because you're saying you want three pieces of this kind of item and it costs this much. But let's say you switch it around. I'm going to put price first and then quantity. And then I press run. It doesn't really make sense because you're saying that you want 49.95 pieces of something. And that doesn't really make sense because you can't have 0.9 pieces of something. So make sure that when you're using this with multiple variables, you need to put it in the correct order. And you can like change these values too if you want to. You could say, I want it to be $30, and I want item number 25, and then I want 100 of them. If I press run, now it says, I want 100 pieces of item 25 for $30. So, yeah, there's a lot of ways you can change it to make different sentences. Okay, this one's, this is a little more confusing, but let me explain this one, the same example first. So, this is our number one spot, number two spot, number three spot, where I'm going to give them indexes. So this is index 0, this is index 1, this is index 2. So 0, 1, 2. Quantity goes in the first spot, item number goes in the second spot, and price goes in the third spot. But let's say I accidentally switched it around, and I put quantity as the third one. This is, if I run, it's not going to print out the correct order because it says I want 25 pieces of item 30.0 for $100. That's not true. I want item number 25 and I want 100 pieces of them and it only costs $30, not $100. So in order to switch the order around, I don't need to change this part. I can change this. So here I'm going to put 1, 2, and 0. This means that this is index 0. I'm going to put, it's 0, 1, and 2. Okay, so this is saying that index 0, which is item number, it goes right here. Index 1, which is price, goes here, and quantity goes here. So you can switch up the order like this and then it's going to print out correctly. But you should try to not use these numbers and just make sure that your variables are in the correct spot so that it doesn't get confusing. So yeah, just try to put them in order according to what you want to have here, or else you're going to have to match them up with the index number. Okay. So there's something called escape characters. It's basically, let's say you want to have a sentence and you want to have quotes inside of it, right? Because sometimes, let's say you're quoting a book or some kind of phrase, you need to use these quotes, but you can't just input them like this because when you run it, you're going to get an error. So what you need to do is use something called an escape character. Basically, it's just the backward slash and then the quotation mark. So if you just put a backward slash before each quotation mark, it's going to print out like this. Make sure you don't use the normal, normal slash. You need to make sure it's like facing towards the left or else it's not going to work. So you press run. Let me try this. Oh, sorry. I need to print TXT. Okay. Now, if I print it, it's going to say, "We are the so-called Viking." And it has it in commas now. So, quotation mark. Now it has it in quotation marks. It says, "We are the so-called Vikings from the north." So yeah, if you want to put quotation marks around something, just make sure to put this backslash before each of your quotation marks. And you can do the same thing with single quotation marks. You can just put them like this, and then it's all going to print out together. Just like this. It's a single quote. And yeah, there's a bunch of them, but mostly the important ones are just this backslash before your quotes. You can also make a new line. In the beginning of our lesson today, we learned about multi-line strings, but if you don't want to do that, you can just use this. You can just use backslash n, and then it's going to put something on a new line. So let me press run. And says, hello world in two lines. So, yeah, if I take this out, it's just going to be hello world in one line. If I print it like this, now it's on two lines. Yeah, and there's also tab. This one, if you just put it at the beginning, like T, it's going to make a space before your word. So yeah, like let's say you want to write a whole paragraph in Python, then you can just use tab to show that it's the beginning of your paragraph. Yeah. Okay, this is a list of all of the string methods. I know we went over some of them, like we went over lower and we went over upper. Yeah, upper's right here. Split, we also learned how to do that, and we also learned how to do replace. So yeah, there's a bunch of different methods that you can use. Basically, how you use these, just make sure you have some type of string. I'm gonna make a string here, it's called hello world. Once you have your string, then you can use a method. So I want to capitalize the first word. The first letter, I'm just going to say txt.capitalize. I'll make it lowercase. And if I press run and I say txt.capitalize, it's going to have a capital H. So, yeah, you can use any of these. You just put dot and then the method. And then you can do whatever you want with it. If you guys look at this website, I'll send it in general chat. Okay, I just sent this link in general chat for you guys if you want to look later. But basically, this is a whole list of different methods in Python that you can use. So capitalize converts the first character of the string to uppercase. Casefold converts string into lowercase. And so on. There's like a lot of different things you can do with methods. And yeah, but the main ones we already looked over. Yeah. And if you guys have any questions about like these, when you go over them on your own, you can just let us know. Okay. I think Davin, are you going to do some exercises now, or am I going to do these ones?
I was thinking of just going straight to functions, but I'm not sure.
Oh, okay. Then I guess I'll just try
one. I don't think we have to do the exercises first.
Okay. Then I'll stop sharing, and then we can do functions.
Okay, cool. I'll start by sharing my screen. Okay. Can you guys see my screen? Muted. I'm assuming you guys can see my screen.
Sorry, I'm connecting now.
Yeah, we can see it now.
Okay. Cool. Okay. So yeah, I'll be going over Python functions. Python functions are blocks of code that you can define where like you have to pass in some kind of input, and then you're going to define some kind of way to pass an output. So to begin, this is how you create a function. You use the def keyword, so it's this one, and then you define like the name of the function. And in these parentheses, you would put in like the inputs you want, or like nothing if you don't want any inputs. Then you're going to do something with all those inputs. So this is an example. I'm going to use VS Code, which I believe is being installed on your computers right now. So that's this one. This allows you to run code locally. So to start, I'll just create a Python file called main.py. Hopefully you guys can see this. Yeah, okay. And so like we can run local files here. So for example, if I put print hello world, then you can run that locally. You can see that. Okay, cool. So I'll show you guys how to define a function. So we can just copy this code here. And so this is just going to create a function called myFunction. And if you run the function, it's going to print hello from a function. So if you run it by itself, it's not going to do anything. In order for it to be doing something, you have to go outside the function like this. And then you have to call it. So you type in the name of the function and you put in the parentheses. And so if you do that, you're going to get the output. So here you can see it says hello from a function. One important thing to keep in mind is that the indents here are important. Everything that's like inside the function here you can see is indented. And then when you come out of the function, you have to go back in the previous like line spacing. So next is calling a function. Oh, I guess I just did that. So to call a function, use the function name, and then you use parentheses. The parentheses tells the computer that it's a function as opposed to like a variable. So functions can take in arguments. So arguments are like the inputs of the function, what you want the code to have when you're running it. So in this case, we can see that you're passing in the name, and then we're returning resnessf after it for some reason. Okay, I'll just demonstrate the code. So here the argument is fname. This is the input. And then you're printing that name followed by refsness. Yeah. And so you can pass in different inputs here. If I run it, it's going to be run for every single different like input value. So for this time, you're running my function, and the input you're putting in is email. So you're printing this. Next, you're running the function again, except your input is Tobias. So you're printing Tobias plus like this word. Same thing with minus. Cool. So if you ever have a chance to read Python documentation, it says args instead of arguments. You can think of those as inputs, but yeah, I think formally they're called arguments. Yeah. So this is just talking about the distinction between parameters and arguments. So it says the parameter is the value listed inside the parentheses in the function definition. So that's this stuff. And it says the argument is the value that is sent to the function when it is called. So argument is when you're passing in the input here, and then when you receive the input, you're calling it a parameter here. So number of arguments, a function must be called with the correct number of arguments, yeah. So you have to pass in the correct inputs that you expect, otherwise it doesn't work. So going back to this function over here, for example, you can see that we define like the parameters here so that it must receive an input value called fname. So if I just try to run the function by itself, like this, then we're going to get an error, yeah. And the error just tells us that we're missing one of the arguments called fname. Similarly, if we put in too many things, for example, if I put in like A, B, C, I don't know why I do this, but for example, I'm passing in three arguments here, and we're going to get an error again because we're supposed to only pass in one input, but we're passing in three. So that's not allowed. That's incompatible. But if I do put in like the correct number of arguments, so if I just put in A, for example, then the function is going to run correctly. I can put in like hello or something. It's going to run correctly. Yeah. Okay. Oh yeah, so this is important as well. So sometimes you don't know how many arguments you're going to receive. You don't know how many inputs you're going to receive for your function, and you might want that. So for example, in this case, I guess, you want a list of children, and you don't know how many children there are. And so to do that, you put in this asterisk, like the star character, before the parameter name, which tells the function that it's going to receive a tuple, like a lot of, like several arguments. And so we have to access those. So I'll just run that example code here. Just to like demonstrate, I'll also print out the type of kits, as well as the length of kits. So the function is defined as receiving like any number of inputs, and we're going to put all of those inputs into one tuple called kids, and then we're going to do something with that. Here we're running the function, and we're passing in the arguments email, Tobias, and Linus. So if I run it, you can see that, yeah, kids, we're receiving the input as a tuple, and then there's going to be three kids, which makes sense because in the arguments we pass in three. And then finally, yeah, we're printing the youngest child is, and the second, or rather the third value in the tuple kids. And we can see that the third value here is Linus, so that makes sense. This is also really flexible, like I said. I can put in like a B, C. So now we want there to be six values in our tuple. And you can see that there are six values because we put in six values. Okay. Next, there are keyword arguments. So keyword arguments are this is more for like the programmer. So if you're confused about which argument is which, you can make it more clear in the keyword arguments. We can run the example code. So here the inputs we're receiving are child 3, child 2, and child 1. So the inputs we want to receive are child 3, child 2, child 1. But then, for some reason, I guess we want to pass them in a different order. So we want to pass them in as child 1, child 2, child 3, instead of child 3, child 2, child 1. And so to do that, we use keyword arguments. We're making it clear to the computer which one is assigned to which. So if I run the code, here we're defining the argument child 3 as Linus. And so when we're printing out child 3, we're going to say the youngest child is, and then child 3 is Linus. So that's why it says Linus. If we didn't use this, for example, and then we still put in the names in the same order, and we would get something like this, where instead of using keyword arguments, we would just put in values like this. If you do this, the value is going to be different, because it expects the first value to be for the variable child 3. So the first variable is email, so it's going to print in the youngest child is email. Here, we can bypass that order and define the order for ourselves. If you have questions, please send it in the Discord chat. I think there are people going over that. So you can also have an arbitrary number of keyword arguments. So this is when you don't know how many keyword arguments are going to be passed. So you want to receive a dictionary. Okay. So previously, when there were just arbitrary arguments, you would receive a tuple, where it was just like a list of all the values that they passed in. Here we're receiving a dictionary because you're passing in the name of the variable as well as the value. We're saying that we're going to get an arbitrary number of keyword arguments. And so in order to receive this, we're going to receive it as a dictionary. So we're defining the first variable we pass in as fname, and the second variable we pass in as lname. And then we're putting in the values Tobias and refness. So if I run this, So we access the dictionary for the value called lname, and the value inside of that is refness, yeah. So we're going to print his last name is this thing. So I guess like one thing to pay attention to is that as a programmer, you need to know which variables you're passing in. If I put in something like zname or something, then we're going to get an error because we never passed in a variable called the zname. As you can see here, we pass in fname and lname, but not zname. And so when you're accessing these variables in a dictionary, you need to be careful about what you know you have and what you might not have. So this is default parameter values. So this is when you know you want to set like a default value so that the function will run without the argument. So in this case, we have the function called myFunction, and we're passing in a country. And then we're going to print out I am from this country. So I guess here, if by saying country equals Norway, we're telling the computer to assume that if we don't pass in an input, then we're from Norway. That's an interesting choice. So for example, you can see, I'm going to comment on everything else. If I just run my function by itself, we're going to say I am from Norway. But then if you pass it in with any other inputs, then we're going to get the corresponding countries, right? So if we pass in Sweden, we're going to say I am from Sweden. If you say India, you say I am from India. If you say Brazil, you say I am from Brazil. If you put nothing again, you say Norway. And this doesn't mean that you can't say Norway. You can still put in Norway yourself, but it's just assuming that the default value is Norway. Cool. Okay, so passing a list as an argument, so it doesn't only need to be like strings you're passing in, you can pass in any type of argument inside. So yeah, this is just one example, I guess. So in this case, we want to pass in a list. And so we define, so I guess the first thing to see is that we define a function. And then for every value in the list that we receive called food, we're going to print it. So outside of the function, you know it's outside because this indent is outside. If it was like this, then it would still be inside the function. You have to get like to level to this line. So we're going to define a list called fruits. We're putting in the values apple, banana, and cherry. And then we're going to run the function on this list. So it's going to print out every single value inside of it. Again, if I change the values in here, then what's going to get printed is going to change. Next, there's return values. So so far, the functions we've been using have just been printing things. If we don't want it to just print it right away, we can say that it should return a value. So in this case, we're saying that we want to return, we want to return 5 times the number we receive. So if we just do it by itself, what's going to happen is that we're not going to print anything. Because we receive the value, but we don't do anything with it. If you put this inside a print, then it's going to print out that value. So we're putting in x equals 1. We're passing x equals 1. And then we're going to multiply 5. So we should expect it to print 5. And as you can see, that's what happens. It prints 5. If you change the function values, then different numbers will happen. So if I put in 25, 25 times 5 will come up, which is 125. The pass function, pass statement, sorry. So this is if you want to define a function, this is usually when you're like writing your code and you're not done yet. You want to just define a function and not have anything inside of it. So you can just put pass. Pass is just going to say do nothing right now. So we can still call like my function 1, and there's not going to be any error. If we don't put in pass as a placeholder, there's going to be an error right away. You can see that red line. And it's going to say, what's going on? You have nothing inside your function. Recursion. So this is a little complicated. I'm not sure how much I should go over this. let's go over the basics for now. Recursion is when you're defining a function that needs itself to process things. So previously, for example, we had a function, and then we just did something, right? And then we outputted the result. Recursion is when you like rely on yourself to continue. This is a weird example. I guess like a common example is the Fibonacci sequence. Yeah. So maybe I should... This looks a little complicated. I'll just show the Fibonacci sequence. The Fibonacci sequence is when it's like the sequence of numbers where it's like starts at 1, 1, and then you always get the next value by adding the previous two values. So it should be like 1, 1, 2, and then 1 plus 2 is 3, 2 plus 3 is 5, 3 plus 5 is 8, and so on. So maybe we want to be printing out that sequence. So we receive a number called n. So yeah, n is like the nth number in the sequence. So if we're starting with the first number in the sequence, if n equals 0, then we want to print 1. If we're starting with the next number, so if n equals 1, then we also want to print 1. And then otherwise, we want to print some of the previous two values. So the previous two values are fib sequence n minus 2 plus fib sequence n minus 1, right? So n is the nth number and nth value in the sequence. So n minus 1 is the one right before that, and n minus 2 is the one right before that. And so if we run this sequence, so we're saying print out the first 10 values, for example, then we're going to get, oh wait, what happened? If n equals 1, 2, oopsie, return. We should be returning the values because we want to rely on that feature. Nice, okay, this is what I meant. So yeah, this is something important. For recursion, you want to be passing a value because otherwise you can't be using it in the future. So yeah, you can print 89. I guess I'll just show you like the first few values in the sequence. And so this is a way of just getting like the first value. So it's 1, 1, and then 1 plus 1 is 2. 1 plus 2 is 3. 2 plus 3 is 5. And so we're using the same function in order to calculate the previous ones. And the first statements are called base cases, so that it doesn't run infinitely. This is just a short example. You'll learn more about these in the future. Okay, cool. So we'll just start an exercise, and then I'll assign the rest for homework. So we have this document called Warm Up 1. It should be in the Google Drive with all the materials. And so these are like a bunch of exercises that we're going to be doing for practice. And so, yeah, all of these are going to be in the format of functions, which makes it easier to test the code on different input values and such. So the problem here reads, parameter weekday is true if it is a weekday, and the parameter vacation is true if we are on vacation. Sleep in if it is not a weekday or we're on vacation. Return true if we sleep in. So for the first example, we're passing in false. So we're saying that it's not a weekday. And then we're also saying that it is not a vacation, because this first parameter corresponds with the variable weekday, as it says here. And then the second value corresponds with the variable vacation. And since we're not on, it's not a weekday, and we're not on vacation, we're going to return true that we sleep in, as it says here. So then in another case, we're saying that it is a weekday, and we're saying that we are not on vacation. So it is a weekday, and we're not on vacation. So none of these values are, like, none of this statement holds true, so we return false. So I'll just demonstrate this. So we can go back to our code here. Because I think a good practice when we're doing practice problems like this is to create different files corresponding to each one. So in this case, I'll create a new file and call it warm-up 1 and problem 1. Pi. Don't forget .py to make sure it's a Python file. And then so we'll define the function. It says it's called sleepin. And then it should receive in two parameters called weekday and vacation. So that's what we put inside the parentheses. And then we put the colon to indicate that we're going to define a function. And so for now, I'm just going to put in pass because I haven't written the code yet. In terms of the testing code, we're going to have something that looks like this. So we're going to put in our answer, a variable called answer, and then we're going to call sleep in and put our values. So for example, we put false, false as a test case here. So we're going to put in false, false. We want to print answer. And then we want to do something like this for all the test cases that we're given. They say they also want us to test true, false, so we can put in true, false. And they also want us to test false, true, so we can put in false, true. And so each time it's going to run it, it's going to store the value in a variable called answer, and it's going to print it out. It does the same thing each time. Okay, so now to actually define our code. So really, we can just like convert all of what it says here from English into code. So I'm just going to copy this actual statement here and then put it in a comment. I'm just going to put it here. Okay. Okay. So first it says that like weekday, this just means true if it's a weekday, and this is true if it's vacation. So this just tells us if we're on a weekday or vacation. And then it says we sleep in if it is not a weekday or you're on vacation, we return true if we sleep in. So the first case, if it is not a weekday, so if not weekday, or we're on vacation, so or vacation. And we return true. Else, we return false. Right, so this is just converting this straight into English. It says if it is not a weekday or we're on vacation, so if not a weekday or a vacation, then we return true. And so we can run this code and we will get our answers. So we got true, false, true. If you look at the answers they gave us, it's true, false, true. So these are the values that we expected. Okay, so yeah, this is the format that we want to be working on all these exercises for all of them in the future. We want to define the function, so we call it def. We put in the name of the function like this. So in this case, it'd be monkey trouble. And then we put in the inputs we want to take. So here it says that we want to take weekday and vacation. It says we want parameters A smile and B smile. So that's what we'd put in here. And then we put in the colon, and then we put in our code. And then when we want to test it, we just use this kind of format where you put answer equals the name of the function and the arguments. I think that's it for functions. Serena?
Yeah, so we have some time left, but since we weren't able to really like do the problems together, I think it's okay to end it here. And I'll also send this document to you guys so you can finish it as homework. And I think now you guys are able to use VS Code. So you guys can type all the homework directly on VS Code.
Okay.
Have any questions? Yeah, if they're able to log on to Discord later, If they have homework questions, they can ask. Or and since we weren't able to go over it a lot, we'll definitely go over it tomorrow. They're able to connect the fall.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, I'll send the homework right now. Okay, I posted the homework and you guys can do it on VS Code. And we'll also post the recording and then we have the live lecture notes so you guys can look at it again if there's any confusion about the lecture we went over today.
Okay.
Thank you. See you guys tomorrow.
Bye.
Bye.